Number three, وَالْتَذْكُرُ الْمَوْتَ وَالْبِلَىٰ. You remember death and the disintegration of your bones and your body. وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ تَرَكَ زِينَةَ الدُّنْيَا. Whoever hopes and desires to have a beautiful abode in the hereafter, he will stop running after the material things of this world. فَمَنْ فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ. Whosoever has done these four things. فَقَدْ إِسْتَحْيَا مِنَ اللَّهِ حَقَّ الْحَيَاءِ. That indeed he has led a modest life, and he has led a life of bashfulness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has kept a barrier between himself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Respected brothers and sisters, this is a key point of haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today we live in a world in which secrets don't remain secrets. Everyone's worried about online privacy. Rightfully so. Nothing remains private anymore. Cameras can be remotely switched on. Microphones can be remotely switched on. Cell phones can be remotely switched on. We live in a time when people are paranoid over their secrets being lost, their medical issues being exposed, their credit report being exposed, their actions of the night being exposed. We live in a time when people are always wondering, how do you find out? How did he find out? And news spreads definitely like wildfire. There's no doubt about that. Social media spreads like wildfire. So a person, to a certain degree, those who have some iman and faith in them, they feel conscious of this, that I don't want other people to know about this. I don't want other people to know about my actions. And that's good. Alhamdulillah. That's one level. That's a great level. Because there are people who don't even have that, and who shamefully expose themselves, shamefully talk about their sins, as known as the mujahir. Those who openly discuss in public what they have done. Allah covered up their faults, but since they are so shameless, they don't care. They share it in front of other people and say, what is Allah going to do anyway? That type of attitude. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, everyone may be forgiven. In a near meaning of hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shower his blessings. People turn to Allah, Allah will forgive them, except for that mujahir. That one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bata yasturuhu rabbuhu ta'ala. He spent the night where Allah covered up his faults, and in the morning he himself went and exposed it. Because what made him expose it? La ubali. I don't care. What's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to do? That attitude is, of course, something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes intensely. So, brothers and sisters, that's the basic level. But beyond that, there's another level where a person says, it's not about people. It's about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, subhanAllah, when someone who comes from a respectable family, and the child or the young boy or young girl, man, woman, whoever, the son or the daughter is using foul language. He's angry, he's upset. But when that old grandfather, old elderly mother walks in, those who come from good backgrounds, they feel ashamed that I can't continue speaking like this. I'm angry, I'm upset. It's not like this grandfather of mine or this elderly mother is gonna hit me now. But that's what you call haya. That's you call you feel ashamed that in front of my mother, I'm not gonna speak like this. In front of my elderly grandparents, I'm not gonna speak like this. Although a person is not afraid, but there's that level of haiba, there's that level of ta'zeem, there's that level of genuine regard that a person feels ashamed of doing something of that nature in front of his elders. So that is also a great level, because many, many people don't have this anymore. In front of their own parents, in front of their own elders, they act as though no one's there. And they think that, I'm not scared about this. I've got nothing to worry, I've got nothing to hide. My brothers and my dear sisters, this is what you call someone who has lost all concept of modesty, all concept of haya. You're right. You can do whatever you want. Because what did the Prophet ﷺ say? إِذَا فَاتَكَ الْحَيَاءَ فَفْعَلْ مَا شِئْتَ. If you lose that concept of haya, then do as you like, because it's over. Your case is closed. Your case is closed. If you really don't care what people think about you, what elders think about you, what youngsters think about you, what little children, your own kids think about you, then the chances of turning around are very slim. Because at the end of the day, a person may slip and fall, but it's the fear of what people may say about me, what my little children are going to think about me, what my parents are going to think about me when my faults are exposed. That holds it. That's radi', that holds us back. But when a person loses that, like a serial killer, he doesn't care, for example, then it's really very difficult to bring that person back. Then there's the next level of that. The haya from people is there. The haya from elders is there. The haya from angels is there. The haya from awliya and righteous people is there. The haya from parents is there. But then there's the ultimate haya, the haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where a person is in the middle of nowhere, in a desert, alone, or in the darkness of a room, in a night. There's no parents, there's no children, there's no cameras, there's no microphones, there's no cell phones, there's no technology of any sort, for example. But still a person has this belief that the one who I ought to be afraid of, or the one who I ought to be careful of in front, most definitely is with me here. As the poet has so beautifully said, وَإِذَا مَا خَلَوْتَ بِرَيْبَةٍ فِي ظُلْمَةٍ وَالنَّفْسُ دَاعِيَةٌ إِلَى الطُّغْيَانِ فَاسْتَحْيِي مِن نَظْرِ الْإِلَهِ وَقُلْ لَهَا إِنَّ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الظَّلَامَ يَرَانِي. That whenever you are alone in the darkness of the night, in the darkness of a room, it's you, your nafs, and the sin presenting itself to you. وَالنَّفْسُ دَاعِيَةٌ إِلَى الطُّغْيَانِ. And your carnal desires are pulling you, are inviting you, are seducing you to break an order of Almighty Allah and commit a sin. Then the poet says, فَاسْتَحْيِي مِن نَظْرِ الْإِلَهِ. Then at the very least, have shame, have haya from the vision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the sight of Allah. And tell your nafs that although no one is with me here, there are no security cameras, there is no technology, there's no one watching me except for me and the sin. إِنَّ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الظَّلَامَ يَرَانِي. But indeed, the one who created this darkness is most definitely watching me. The one who created these layers of darkness is most definitely with me. أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with you wherever you may be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةُ الْأَعْيُنُ وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ. All aware of what a person is doing. That haya if a person has within him or herself, subhanAllah, it will take him to great heights. Haya from Allah. That my Allah has done so much for me. Why do we have that concept? In front of my mother, I'll keep quiet. In front of my teacher, I'll keep quiet. In front of my grandparents, no, I can't do that. Why? Because I'm indebted to them. They've raised me from day one. They've done everything for me. Out of respect for this elder who has done so much for me, I'm going to zip my mouth. I'm going to control my emotions. That's what we do. But my brothers and sisters, there's no one who showered us with more blessings than our Creator, our Lord, from day one till the last day. And beyond that, once we're in the grave, and then when the real life begins of the hereafter, we are only and only at the mercy of our Lord, Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There has to be a level of haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. And if that's lost, then the opportunities to sin are going to be endless. As we move forward today, in these days, in this modern day and age, technology has made sinning something of a second nature. Sin is something which is in our pockets, which is at our fingertips. It is with us in the masjid. It is with us at the haram. It is with us in ihram. It is with us in hajj and umrah. It is with us in the month of Ramadan. It is with us in the graveyards. It is with us everywhere. The ability to commit sin of all sorts is at our fingertips. A person can use a cell phone to gamble. A person can use a cell phone to order drinks. A person can use a cell phone to look at haram, to order haram. All kinds of stuff can happen with a person's fingertips. Credit card is there, phone is there. The possibilities of sin are endless. The possibilities of sin are endless. Now at that time, subhanAllah, for a person to not be able to fall into this trap, what's going to be required? Haya from Allah. What does it mean to have haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained that. And he explained that it would be that حِفْظُ الرَّأْسُ وَمَا وَعَى. Protect the head and whatever it comprises of. Meaning protect that tongue. Protect those ears. Protect those eyes. Protect the mouth from eating and consuming haram. This tongue is moving at a very fast pace. In seconds, I can tear away at someone's honor. I can attack someone's honor in seconds. In 1 second, I can attack a whole community, a whole masjid, thousands of people, a nation, a gender, a ethnicity. Very quickly, this tongue can do damage that a huge arsenal of bombs can't do. Very quickly, a person with this tongue can dig such a deep pit for himself that the world's bulldozers won't be able to dig such a deep pit for oneself. As quickly as this tongue does, by the misuse of it, whether it's backbiting, whether it's slander, whether it's accusations against one another, subhanAllah, raising doubts against people about people's honor, all of that is done. Haya from Allah is, brother, what am I saying? What am I saying? I mean, subhanAllah, this person is not present in front of me, so now his meat is good for all, we can attack it as we wish. The honor is open for all, it's a buffet, we can attack as we wish. A person has haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that these words I'm going to be held accountable for. Al-bala'u muwakkalun bil-mantiq. That musibah and problems are clinging onto speech. As soon as a person speaks, the masa'ib and difficulties pour down upon him. in this world or most definitely in the next. That's why the Prophet ﷺ says, رَأْسَ وَمَا وَعَى. Protect the tongue. Protect the ears from listening to ghibah. Listening to people, you know, useless, cheap jokes about people's honor. You know, indecent type of jokes. Protect our ears from that because they have an effect. Don't think it's out the one year, in the one year and out the other year. Absolutely not. It's damaging. Like looking at a murder scene. Allah forbid. Allah protect us from having to ever see something like that. But you know, it's traumatizing, right? This is traumatizing psychologically. Similarly, watching sin, listening to sin is traumatizing to the soul. And the soul will suffer for ages, years. We see sometimes people in their 40s and 50s having serious spiritual problems. And if they open up to you, you realize that it's what happened during their youthful years. Mistakes that were made that they're suffering 40 years later, 30 years later. Because it's trauma. The spirit, the ruh, the soul has suffered. It was beaten up horribly. It was abused at a young age. So much sin was committed. So much sin was seen. So much sin was heard. That now it's very difficult for that soul to get purified. We've never given a chance to heal. You know, subhanAllah, you're beating down upon someone. Give him a week, 2 weeks to heal. But when he came to the soul, day after day, night after night, it was back to it. Back to the sin. Back to the sin that the soul did not get an opportunity to rejuvenate. The soul did not get an opportunity to connect itself with Allah and get some energy. Like this, ruh, spiritual feed for our soul. In the dhikr of Allah, in the recitation of the Quran, in salah, in performing wudu, in feeding the poor, in wiping our hands over the heads of the orphans. These are things that bring spirituality to our heart, give strength to our ruh. But if a person didn't do that and constantly sinned again and again, day in, day out, then that spirit, that soul takes a huge hit. The eyes, of course, are part of the head as well. That a person, whatever he sees, he has to ensure that he uses those eyes to see that which will take him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Looking at ni'am of Allah, looking at the nature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pondering over if this flower is so beautiful, if this sky is so beautiful, if the starlit sky is so beautiful, imagine the khaliq of this, how beautiful this must be, subhanallah. Imagine the creator of this, how much it must be. Brothers and sisters, we need to gain an appreciation of our Lord. We have thank you cards for each other. We say, subhanAllah, thank you 2 times for someone who opens a door for us. We feel obliged to someone who gives us a bottle of water. For someone who, subhanAllah, waited for us to bypass them at a red light or a green light. And we wave at them. Everyone, we value what they do for us, save Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is that one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How often do we sit and say, Ya Allah, I am so thankful for what you have done for me. I'm so grateful for what you have done for me. You have showered me with beautiful parents. You've showered me with a beautiful spouse. You've showered me with children. You've showered me with health and wealth. All that you have given me, Ya Allah, I want to simply say thank you. I simply want to say, Ya Allah, that I'm appreciative and I am not deserving of this. Continue to shower me with these blessings. Do not allow my ungratefulness to become a means of myself being deprived of these blessings. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min zawali ni'matik. Oh Allah, I seek a refuge in you from the blessings being removed from me. From the fall of the blessings that you have showered upon me. Wa tahawwuli 'afiyatik. And oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from your well-being that you have given me to be moved away to someone else, away from me. Wa jami'i sakhatik. And anything and everything that will bring upon me your anger and wrath. The Prophet ﷺ said, the next thing that a person needs to be ensuring is وَلْيَحْفَظِ الْبَطْنَ وَمَا حَوَى. That person protects the stomach and whatever's around it, the private parts. A person needs to have haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person says, the youth who says, I can't guard my gaze. I can't stop myself from this addiction that I have. Yes, brothers and sisters, when do you do this? I do it when I'm alone. I do this when no one is watching. I do this with just me and her. SubhanAllah, brothers and sisters, you are not alone. You have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watching you at every given moment. I have Allah watching me. Every single time that nafs tells you that you can commit this because no one is there, and you say, I'm being overwhelmed by my nafs. I'm being overwhelmed by my desires. Remind yourself that Allah is watching with a much clearer vision than this camera here, than all the cameras in this room here. Wallahi al-azim. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instantaneously can shut down those eyes. If he doesn't do it today, he can do it tomorrow. He can do it at the age of 50 or 60. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make my hands paralyzed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make this beautiful face suffer. And this is exactly what stopped Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam When Zulaykha was calling out to him, what was the thing that stopped him? It was haya from Allah. Innahu Rabbi ahsana mathwa'i. How can I do this? It's my Lord. One tafsir of this, my Lord, not referring to Aziz al-Misr, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My Lord has been so kind to me. He pulled me out right now from the bottom of the well and gave me the king's palace. And you're asking me to break that trust? So whether it's drinking, using of intoxicants, or fornication, it's not about what people will say. It's not about what your wife will say. It's not about what your husband will do if he finds out. It's not about what your friends will do. My brothers and sisters, let's have some shame from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have some shame from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is watching. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I cry crocodile tears in front of on a day when everyone's watching, Khatmul Quran night, Eid day, or other nights, say, Ya Allah, please forgive me, I've done this and this. When we get in trouble, we come rushing back. What about that Allah who deep down everyone knows that it's only Him who can make our affairs come right? How can we have the audacity to commit the most huge major sins, knowing very well that Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us, watching, looking, hearing as we speak? When there is an employee of yours, when there's a subordinate of yours, when there's someone who reports to you, and they have no one to assist them, no lawyers, doesn't have the wealth and the means to hire anyone, and now the ball is in your court. Have fear from Allah and haya from Allah, that Ya Allah, I can definitely oppress this person. I can twist this person's arm. I can blackmail this person. But Ya Allah, there's going to be a day when I'm going to be standing in front of you. And I fear that day. So Ya Allah, out of haya from you, although no one knows this, and I've got him under me, but I am definitely not going to misuse this. When we have our wife in front of us, and subhanAllah, things get heated, and a person sees that, yes, there's no one there. I can scream, I can yell, I can scold. And there's little children watching and listening. Our person has to have haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not from anyone else, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah made me responsible of this wife. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to ask me about how I treat this wife. And that wife, when she gets upset and angry in front of her husband, and her husband is there, children are there, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is definitely going to question me how I treated my husband, how I ran that house. I have to have haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Forget about the parents. Forget about in-laws. They all come secondary. Number one is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How am I going to face Allah? When the nafs comes and tell you, just go buy a ticket, a lottery ticket, it's all right. When the nafs comes and tell you, hold a drink. When the nafs comes and tell you, this is a small fornication, this is not the real fornication, etc., etc. Brothers and sisters, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you and I the wealth to do this, the health to do this, the hands and feet and the eyes to do this. It's just not even a second. Kun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply has to order it and all these faculties will be shut down. Will be shut down. If it doesn't get shut down today, a time will come when you and I will be reflecting on our past lives and we say, oh, is this why I'm suffering? Is this why I'm suffering at the hands of my own children? I'm suffering at the hands of my own spouse. I'm suffering at the hands of my own employees. I'm suffering at the hands of my own relatives and community members. And a person will see like a film reel. And all those sins that he or she has done in the past, when they had no shame from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will become exposed. And a person at that time, and definitely if not at the end of age, definitely at the time of death, this film will begin. This blockbuster, subhanAllah, has never been seen before. Each one has got his own special movie. And the actor is none other than myself and yourself. And we will see what caused us to come this day. Brothers and sisters, before that day comes, Rasulullah, that's why I ended this hadith. He said, وَلْيَذْكُرِ الْمَوْتَ وَالْبِلَىٰ. If you want to have true haya from Allah, then remember death and remember when your bones are going to get disintegrated in the grave. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked us to remember this. Respected friends, brothers and sisters, we are alive, we're healthy. We have the opportunity now to have haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I speak this for myself, number one. I am in need the most for what I say. Let us pray to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us from amongst those who have haya. Say ameen. That He makes us from amongst those who protect the head and all the organs that are around it. And he makes us from amongst those who protect our stomach and their private parts. And yet we pray and beg to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allows us to have shame from Him. That He allows us to truly, truly love Him the way He ought to be loved. And to fear Him the way He ought to be feared. And allow us to lead a life in such a manner that when we leave this world, He is looking forward to meeting us. And we are looking forward to meeting Him. Respected friends, as I end, I want to remind you, the part of haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and desire for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that we desire to go visit His house. We desire to go visit His house. وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. We are 3 weeks left from the beginning of the Asfar for Hajj. Dhul Qa'dah has begun, and very soon Dhul Hijjah will begin. Brothers and sisters, if we are sitting here, and we are from amongst those people upon whom Hajj is fard, you and I have the wealth, Then, respected brothers and sisters, let us have haya from Allah. That how can I leave this world? What if my death comes to me and I have not visited the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How will I face Allah by saying I've done grand tours of the world? I have been to cruises, but I didn't have time to come visit your house. You have still a couple weeks left. If you're sitting here listening to this and hajj is fard upon you, I urge you, I encourage you to have that firm belief and resolve that Allah will take care of my affairs. Let me raise my hand in Jumu'ah time and say, Ya Allah, I want to visit your house. I want to fulfill this obligation of hajj. Make it easy for me. Allow my affairs to come right. And inshaAllah ta'ala, you make that intention and Allah will invite you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easy for you. I pray that Allah accepts the hajj of the hujjaj. Say ameen. And accept the dua of the hujjaj. Say ameen. And Allah accepts all the du'as and the supplications of the hujjaj in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the Haramain Sharifain. We pray to Allah that Allah protects the hujjaj. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah protects all the Haramain Sharifain and Masjid al-Aqsa and all our masajid and all dini institutions. Qala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fil Qur'an al-Majid ba'da a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu attaqullaha wa qulu qawlan sadida yuslih lakum a'malakum wa yaghfir lakum dhunubakum wa man yuti'i Allaha wa rasulahu فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وبارك على سيدنا محمد وأزواجه وذريته. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أرحم أمتي بأمتي أبو بكر رضي الله عنه وأشدهم في أمر الله عمر رضي الله عنه وأصدقهم حياء عثمان رضي الله عنه وأقضاهم علي رضي الله عنه عن جميع الصحابة والصحابيات أجمعين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم احفظ الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أصلحنا واصلح شبابنا واصلح نساءنا وردنا إلى الإسلام ردا جميلا، وردنا إلى الإسلام ردا جميلا. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل، ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى من القول والعمل والفعل والنية والهدى، إنك على كل شيء قدير. عباد الله رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العلي العظيم يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. هيا للصلاة هيا للصلاة هيا للفلاح هيا للفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
استوى اعتدلوا تراصوا سدوا الخلل. Make sure the heels on the line. Ensure that we stand shoulder to shoulder and that there are no gaps. جزاكم الله خيرا.
الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. وسيق الذين اتقوا ربهم إلى الجنة زمرا حتى إذا جاءوها وفتحت أبوابها وقال لهم خزنتها سلام عليكم طبتم فادخلوها خالدين. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين وقالوا الحمد لله الذي صدقنا وعده وأورثنا الأرض نتبوأ من الجنة حيث نشاء فنعم أجر العاملين الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Jazakallah khair, Mufti Azeem. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you with the best of this world and the next. Alhamdulillah, just a word of information, inshallah, tomorrow, actually at Dar al-Salam, on the other side of Lombard, Mufti Azeem and the Dar al-Salam Institute will be holding a Hajj seminar. So for those brothers and sisters who are interested in planning on going for Hajj this year, it'll be a wonderful opportunity to get some background information and perfect your journey of a lifetime. Next Friday, inshallah, the Islamic Foundation Youth will be holding their inaugural event, Real Talk, inshallah, it's planning to be every 2 weeks. We're going to have a Real Talk program. This week's program will be topicked on getting back to school, who am I, and your general Islamic identity. That program will be on August the 19th from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock here at the Islamic Foundation, and Sheikh Hisham, myself, will be the speaker at that program. Also, if just outside in the hallway as you're leaving the masjid, you'll notice that there are voter registration booths. For the brothers and sisters who have not registered to vote yet, inshallah, please do take advantage of this opportunity and uphold your civic duty to be a part of the lawmaking process in this wonderful country in which we live. Voter registration is open. Inshallah, if you have your ID with you, you can take a form and register to vote today so that you can be a part of the solution tomorrow. On August the 21st, that's going to be next Sunday, there will be a program in regards to Syrian refugees in which members from the community who have worked in refugee camps in Greece, Jordan, and Syria itself, doing the humanitarian and volunteer efforts, physicians who have seen firsthand the situation on the ground. Come and hear their experiences and find out what you can do to help, even in the smallest way. That program will be Sunday, August the 21st, from 2 to 4 here at the Islamic Foundation in Villa Park. As always, to stay up to date with all of our programs and all of our events going on at the Foundation, you can sign up for the Islamic Foundation weekly newsletter. That can be done by going to the website. You can join the Facebook page and receive weekly updates as well through there. Or you can even download the handy Islamic Foundation app, which will keep you up to date and aware of all of the latest programs in also, as you're always reminded, please donate generously for your Islamic foundation, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you greater on a day when you will be most in need for it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept and protect the entire ummah wherever we may be and whatever we are going through. Jazakumullahu khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى ومن يعص الله ورسوله فإنه قد غوى لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا إخوتي الكرام أوصي نفسي وإياكم بتقوى الله قال سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما فأسأل الله يجعلني وإياكم من الفائزين في الدنيا والآخرة اللهم آمين وبعد. My dear respected brothers and sisters, mothers and elders and little friends, by the grace and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have been granted the permission by our Creator to come again to His house. We have been granted permission by the fadl, the virtue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us, and I guarantee you it's nothing else than that. The fact that you're here today is not because of where you live, is not because of languages you speak, is not because of how you dress or what you look like or what your name sounds like or how long you've been a Muslim or how long you just converted. None of that matters in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Each and every one of us is a slave before Allah. Everyone. If you thought you were anything better or greater than that before I just said that statement, then you've got it all wrong. But it's okay, because we're here to remember Allah. We're here to remind ourselves of our natural state, and that is that you and I were created for no other reason. So completely eliminate any thought process as to why you think you're here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا negating, وَمَا خَلَقْتْ I did not, for no other reason, create mankind and jinnkind إِلَّا except, now you fill in the blank, لِيَعْبُدُونَ to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the only reason you're here. That's the only reason I'm here. That's the only reason we interact with each other. That's the only reason we go to work. That's the only reason we get married. That's the only reason we deal with children. That's the only reason we wake up and sleep. All of this is for one sole purpose. لِيَعْبُدُونَ to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are servants. We are slaves. We are nothing more than that. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that on the day of judgment, the individual who recognized مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ the place of his Lord, meaning the greatness and the highness and the magnificence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the creator and sustainer and the one who is in charge of everything, the master, and recognizes our individual position as the slaves, for that individual, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises Jannah. Your degree aside, your years of study, put it aside. Your money you inherited or you earned, put it aside. None of that means anything. The only differentiation, the only criteria, the only certification that has any bearing in front of Allah, the only one who anything should matter in front of anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ
The only thing that raises an individual one rank over the other, the only thing, the only certification, the only benefit, the only title that has any bearing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to raise one human over another human is something that you cannot see, something that you cannot earn, something that you cannot study, something that you cannot be given, something only your taqwa. How conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala you are. This is not tied to your gender. This is not tied to your cultural heritage. This is not tied to your wealth or socioeconomic status. This is not tied to whether you can hear or see or feel or touch. This is not tied to your health status. Absolutely, you cannot see taqwa. You don't know and I don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. So that being said, the fact of the matter being that the only criteria that makes anyone better than anyone else is something that you and I can't even see, why are we judging each other? Why are we making labels? Why are we looking at somebody lower than me? Why am I looking at someone higher than me? What does any of that mean? Absolutely nothing in front of Allah. The question has come up recently, given media and recent events, about gender roles in Islam. A certain presidential candidate has recently made remarks regarding a Muslim family that came publicly and spoke quite eloquently about the position of Muslims and our political situation and our scene. And the only comment that was made in response to that eloquent speech was, well, how come his wife didn't say anything? You guys know what I'm talking about. I'm not CNN, I don't need to tell you. How come his wife didn't say anything? How come his wife was silent? How come his wife stood behind him? How come his wife, why didn't? And that raised a lot of questions, alhamdulillah, within our own community as far as what is the role or what is the concept of gender, I'll say it politely, equality in Islam. Does it exist? Does it not exist? Is it an issue? Is it something that no one's ever talked about before? What do men do and what do women do? And I understand that when I speak about this issue, I obviously am not a female, and women can get upset, and I apologize in advance if I try to speak on behalf of women. I know that I'm not a woman. I know that I don't go through the struggles of a woman. I know that you are the mothers and queens of Jannah, and I have nowhere to touch anywhere near your status. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise all of our mothers and all of our sisters and all of our daughters to the highest level of paradise as well as the highest level of this world. Say ameen. I just forced you into that. Our brothers and our sisters, our men and our women, we're different. This is obvious. So the role of a Muslim feminist, now I'm starting to annoy some people. The role of a Muslim feminist, or the role of a individual who tries to seek equality between the genders, or tries to look for how both genders can stand foot to foot, head to head, toe to toe, this is not an Islamic principle. There's no such thing as gender equality in Islam. There's no such thing as gender equality in Islam. You are not made equal because of your gender. I've already said before that the only thing that differentiates an individual over another individual, be that man, be that woman, white, black, Christian, Jew, whatever the case may be, the only thing that separates an individual is taqwa. You cannot see taqwa, but you can see gender. Right? So automatically, there is no equality of one gender over the other. But inherently, with that same thing, there is no priority of gender over the other. Is that understood? That the genders are not equal. It would not be appropriate. It would not be allowable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not oppress one individual by holding them to the standards of another individual. It's not fair. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not expect a man to perform what a woman does. It's not fair. We would fail. And it is not fair for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to expect a woman to do what a man is responsible to do. It's not fair. Both genders are complementary. The male
and the female. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا, so that you find peace with one another. Not separately. Not that you find priority. Not that you find inferiority in one gender over the other. That the male is greater, the woman is greater, whatever. I'm not talking about any of that. Nor am I saying that they are equal. But rather, they are equitable. So rather than the term gender equality, let's look at it as gender equity. That two things that are inherently different, yet of equal value. In front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ أَجْرُ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not waste the good deeds of the males, does not waste the good deeds of the females. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it from each and every one of us. But it's a matter of us recognizing our roles. And this is something that is inherent within all aspects of our society. That when things start to go wrong, it's dhulm, oppression. The classical definition of oppression in Arabic, the classical definition of dhulm in Arabic is to put something where it does not belong. Dhulm in Arabic means to put something where it does not belong. So to expect something from me which I am not capable of achieving, that would be dhulm. For me to try to do something, to put my efforts in a place where they are not welcome or needed, that's putting it where it doesn't belong, that is dhulm. To expect me as a male to give birth to a child, right? You're laughing, right? You're like, no, you wouldn't do that. Yeah, we know Sheikh Hisham to be a man. He's not going physiologically, anatomically, right? I'm incapable of doing that. So now all of a sudden, is one greater than the other because one can give birth and one cannot give birth? The men are looking at it like, no, right? That makes no sense. That's ridiculous. So why apply that same logic to anything that we try to differentiate between a man and a woman? Physiologically, emotionally, spiritually, anatomically, we are different. We cannot be equal. But that does not mean that one is superior over the other. Many proponents or many individuals who argue this point, they point to the ayah in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and they say, no, Shaykh, the men are greater than the women because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الرجال قوامون على النساء. And they stop there. You can't read half the ayah. They say, no, men are greater than women. Men are in charge. Men are on top. قوامون. They use this word and they define it inconsistently. They define it as the men are in charge of the women. Or the men are greater than the women. Or the men are inherently better than the woman. Or the man is stronger than the woman. What about the rest of the ayah? بِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. Meaning, within their role. There are certain things that men are good at. Contrary to what women may believe, there are certain things that men are good at. But on the flip side, there are certain things that women are good at. And when we stick to our roles, when we maintain what we are good at, whether that be as a man or as a woman, be that as an employer or as an employee, or whether that be whatever role we fulfill in society, stick to what you're good at and do it well. And don't try to dabble in things that are of no concern to you. That does not mean, and I want to clarify this, that because the genders are not equal, we've gotten rid of that idea, inshallah. Because there is no superiority of one gender over the other, we've gotten rid of that idea as well. That does not mean that our gender roles are completely segregated and divided. So while it is not advisable to expect a man to physiologically give birth to a child, we do not have the proper anatomy, nor do we have the adequate physiology for that to happen, that does not preclude a man from raising that child. So you see, that's where the complementary elements come in. That one will excel in that field, and the other will complement in that field. That while it is physiologically expected for a man to be responsible for the defense of his household, anatomically and physiologically, right, a larger pelvis and greater upper body strength, on the norm, I'm not talking about like Olympic status here, because we know, mashallah, there's some women in the Olympics that could easily kick me to the curb, alhamdulillah. But physiologically and anatomically, and I know I'm not that big of a guy either, you're looking at me like being, you know, a defender of my household. Physiologically and anatomically, there are things which men are better at, but that does not preclude the woman from supporting her husband in that defense. So you see, the genders are not equal. The genders are not greater than one another, but they are complementary to one another. It is a matter of equity, not equality. Two inherently different things that are of equal value to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have trouble understanding the concept of equity, let me give a short example. That imagine that you're looking to buy a plot of land. And you have the option of buying, you know, a 200 square foot plot of land in downtown Manhattan. Or you have the option of buying, I don't know, 60 acres somewhere out in the middle of Montana. Now those are two very different things, but of equal value. It's going to cost you the same amount of money for either one. So I know this isn't an economics lecture, alhamdulillah, this is Jum'ah, so we're supposed to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How does that apply to the genders? That each couple, each individual, each gender, each person fulfills his specific or her specific roles within society. That is to complement one another. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us both on this earth for that one purpose, and this is where we find the equality, and it is all service to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What a man does is service to Allah. What a woman does is service to Allah. No one's service is better than the other. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it from us all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at the dua of a woman over the dua of a man. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at the good deeds of a man over the good deeds of a woman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says clearly in the Quran, Al-Muhsineena wal-Muhsinat. The people, the righteous men and the righteous women, those individuals who do well that are male, and those individuals who do good that are female, those individuals, in Allah la yudir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not waste the good deeds of any human being. It is not your gender that makes you greater than one. It is not your economic status that makes you better than anyone. It is not your cultural heritage that makes you better than anyone. It is not your years of knowledge that makes you better than anyone. The only differentiation in the eyes of Allah is your taqwa. And how would you gain this consciousness of Allah? Stick to your roles. Do what you do best and don't interfere in the rest. Don't try to assert yourself. This is advice that I give to my brothers that I see very often in lots of marriage counseling issues. That don't assert yourself where your assertion is not welcome. Don't enforce what you are incapable of enforcing. Don't force what you are not given the right or the silsala from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enforce. That's not your business. What Allah has given, take. And what Allah has forbidden, stay away. What the Prophet ﷺ has advised you, take it. What the Prophet ﷺ has advised you to stay away from, stay away from it. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. The Prophet ﷺ was not an oppressor. The Prophet ﷺ was not a chauvinist. The Prophet ﷺ was not a misogynist. فَانْتَهُوا. The Prophet ﷺ was loving. فَخُذُوهُ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was fair, fakhudhu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was honest, so take that and leave the rest. To recognize what we're good at, my brothers and sisters, is the first step to excelling. By dabbling in things that we're not good at, by dabbling in things that we have no right to dabble in, is how we get lost, running around like a chicken with its head cut off. It's your and my responsibility, my brothers and sisters, to learn about our roles, to stay within our roles, and to complement one another. There's no fight between the genders. There's no priority that needs to be achieved one over the other. There's no inherent battle between a man and a woman because they were never meant to battle to begin with. They were never meant to be equal. They were never meant to be superior. So what are we fighting about? They were meant to be, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, complementary to one another. So let's not waste time fighting for our rights. Let's not waste time fighting for gender superiority, because these are fights that will lead nowhere, nor will they achieve anything. But rather, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, ittaqullah wa qulu qawlan sadida. But fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And speak the truth. وَقُولُ قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا And stick to that straight path. Stick to what you're responsible for. Stick to what you're supposed to do. And what will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do for you? يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make your situation easy. All the tension that you have in your family, all the tension you have within your with your spouse, all the tension you have amongst your children, all the tension you have at work, all of these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you stick to what you're supposed to stick to, يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ He'll make it easy. And on top of that, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sins. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا You want to win something? Then follow Allah. And follow His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَوْزًا You will receive that highest reward. You will achieve the victory that you are wanting. And that victory may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us in the highest of Jannah, Al-Firdaus. Allahumma ameen. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم من كل ذنب فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. استغفر. الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة من يطيع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى ومن يعص الله ورسوله فإنه قد غوى لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا قال سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وقال سبحانه وتعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد بعدد من صلى وصام اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد بعدد من قعد وقام اللهم صل على جميع إخوانه من النبيين وعلى سائر الصحابة والتابعين رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وأدخلنا في جنتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين في جميع أنحاء العالمين اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه اللهم أرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم ثبتنا على الإسلام اللهم ثبتنا على الإسلام اللهم أمتنا على الإيمان يا ذو الجلال والإكرام اللهم يا سامع الصوت يا كاسي العظام لحما بعد الموت أسألك يا رحمن أن تجعلنا من أهل الجنة الذين لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون وأن تعتق رقابنا من النار عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أعلى وأولى وأعز وأجل وأهم وأتم وأكبر فأقيموا الصلاة وصلوا الصلاة مودع
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استووا واعتدلوا يرحمكم الله صلوا صلاة مودع pray as if this is your last prayer if it was your last deed to be recorded in your books you would neither want your own prayer to be distracted nor would you wish to distract anyone else's last prayer so be considerate that means silence your cell phones in a polite way
Allahu Akbar. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى تنزيلا ممن خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى الرحمن على العرش استوى له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وما بينهما وما تحت الثرى وإن تجهر بالقول فإنه يعلم السر وأخفى الله لا إله إلا هو له الأسماء الحسنى الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Inshallah, a few announcements for our community. Alhamdulillah, for those brothers and sisters who are planning on going for Hajj this year, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your intention and accept your journey. There will be a Hajj seminar going on at the Darus Salam Foundation, alhamdulillah, just up the street in Lombard. That program will start from Dhuhr tomorrow, 1:30, and is expected to end around 6:30, inshallah. So a lot of information. If it's your first time going or you're repeating, inshallah, get information on how to perfect that journey of a lifetime, alhamdulillah. That's tomorrow at Darus Salam Foundation. Next Friday, the Islamic Foundation Youth, particularly targeted towards high school and college age kids, will be hosting their first event called Real Talk. Inshallah, that program will be here at the Islamic Foundation in the high school library. Program is open for all brothers and sisters, high school age and college age. The program will be a Real Talk event, having an opportunity and a forum to discuss topics and things that are relevant to you today. Inshallah, I will be leading that first discussion, alhamdulillah, open Q&A, really trying to encourage people to get out and talk about what's important to them, inshallah, and really getting some answers and some guidance, inshallah, on some real life issues. That program is going to be on Friday, August the 19th, next Friday, at 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock here at the Islamic Foundation, inshallah. On August the 21st, so next Sunday, the Islamic Foundation is proud to provide a program called Refugees Are Human Beings, in which physicians, community members, and humanitarian workers who have traveled to the actual refugee camps in Syria, Jordan, and Greece to work with refugees, they will be giving their firsthand account of the desperate situation on the ground. You have an opportunity to learn about opportunities that you have an opportunity to learn about chances and opportunities that you can do, alhamdulillah, to try to make a difference, as large or as small as you think it might be. Everything can make a difference. We're all responsible for each other. We're all the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That program is going to be next Sunday here at the Islamic Foundation in the banquet hall downstairs from 2 to 4. So next Sunday afternoon, alhamdulillah, hear about the dire situation from individuals who have seen it firsthand in the medical clinics and in the humanitarian situations, alhamdulillah. Those speakers will be here on Sunday, August the 21st, alhamdulillah. To stay up to date, I know that listening to announcements for 2 minutes after Jummah is a little difficult, especially with people walking out and exiting and getting back to school and work. You can follow Islamic Foundation on Facebook. You'll get all the updates right there, alhamdulillah, as they're posted. You can sign up for the weekly newsletter. So every Thursday night, inshallah, you'll get an announcement as far as who the khatibs are, what events and programs are coming up in the near future, as well as opportunities on how to donate and stay involved and volunteer here at the Islamic Foundation. Or you can also, there is an app for that, download the Islamic Foundation app. You can go to Islamic, you can look for Islamic Foundation Villa Park in Google, as well as Apple iStore, alhamdulillah, iTunes, and inshallah stay up to date to donate generously to your Islamic Foundation and to be an active member of your community. Voter registration is going on outside. Do your civic duty as a Muslim, as an American Muslim. Vote, inshallah, in these upcoming elections, but you can't vote unless you're registered. So inshallah, voter registration is going on outside in the lobby. Please see those brothers and sisters that are volunteering their time, and please be a part of the solution rather than a part of the commentary afterwards when nothing gets done. You have an opportunity, inshallah, go out and take it. We are American, we are Muslim, we are Muslim American. Jazakum Allah khair. May Allah accept and bless each and every one of us. Wassalamu alaikum.